Music, one of the most dazzling fruits of human civilization, is today a massive global phenomenon. And so it's hard for us to imagine a time when, in centuries gone by, people could go weeks without hearing any music at all. Even in the 19th century, you might hear your favorite symphony 4 or 5 times in your whole lifetime, in the days before music could be recorded. The story of music, successive waves of discoveries, breakthroughs, and inventions, is an ongoing process. The next great leap forward may take place in a back street of Beijing or upstairs in a pub in South Shields. Whatever music you're into, Monteverdi or Mantovani, Mozart or Motown, Masho or Mashup, the techniques it relies on didn't happen by accident. Someone somewhere thought of them first. Music can make us weep or make us dance. It's reflected the times in which it was written. It has delighted, challenged, comforted, and excited us. In this series, I've been tracing the story of music from scratch to follow it on its miraculous journey. Misleading jargon and fancy labels are best put to one side. Instead, try to imagine how revolutionary and how exhilarating many of the innovations we take for granted today were to people at the time. There are a million ways of telling the story of music. This is mine. The later half of the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th saw the lives and careers of some of the giants of European music. Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert, Schumann, Mendelssohn, and Chopin. They lived through a time of tremendous social upheaval, the American and French revolutions, the Napoleonic Wars, and yet more revolutions. The turmoil of the times eventually saw music transformed. It became bigger, louder, and more ferocious. And yet, before around 1800, the remarkable fact is that the music doesn't reflect the mayhem that surrounded it. The period from around 1750 to 1850 brought with it seismic social, political, and artistic change. In music, faith and morality, the watchwords of Bach and Handel, gave way to the pleasure principle. Rather than trying to improve their listeners, composers like Haydn and Mozart started pampering them instead. And the rewards from their pampering completely transformed the social status of the composer. The process started with the dapper gentleman servant Haydn, soon morphed into the freelance star turn Mozart, and led to the tormented diva Beethoven. In just his lifetime, composers went from below stairs to high table. The whole function of music and the audience it was aimed at evolved, and evolved dramatically. The music of Haydn, Mozart, Schubert and their contemporaries is many things, but it is very rarely genuinely disturbing or unnerving. In their search for elegance, they produced a ton of music of great beauty, and in their search for sensuality, they made what might have been a grubby existence into something attractive, sensitive and often very touching. And as the pleasure principle took hold amongst Europe's aristocracy, music turned from something morally rigorous or spiritually haunting, to something sensual and intellectually unchallenging, even if it was often jolly stirring. You could say there was a price to pay for this abstraction in music, a lack of meaning and a lack of direct relevance to the times in which it was produced. Because Haydn and Mozart's obedient following of their favourite symphonic formulas could not have come at a more disobedient junction in history. The widespread panic that gripped the European aristocracy at the time of the American and French revolutions is, with some exceptions, very hard to detect in the bulk of the music. It's as if composers felt their job wasn't to join the revolutionaries, but keep the aristocracy calm. Don't panic, ladies and gentlemen, we'll create a virtual world of order and harmony in our symphonies and concertos. If you don't believe me, listen to this. It's what Haydn was writing, his 99th symphony, while the terror raged in Paris and they were cutting off the Queen's head. Whereas composers of previous centuries had on occasions produced music that seems to be a cry of lamentation, here, the music sauntered blithely on. What happened to musical style, then, to reflect this change of attitude and mood? The most noticeable difference was a new approach to chords, the harmony that lay beneath every melody. Complication was replaced with simplicity. Unlike their predecessors, composers of the late 18th century decided there were really far too many chords available and that they needed far fewer for their purposes. They preferred a language that was much simpler. They were interested in great blocks of one chord followed by great blocks of another. Not only did they restrict themselves to a menu of half a dozen chords, there were three chords they used obsessively. One, four, five. In the days when red, white and blue flags were being hoisted all over Europe, those colours are as good a metaphor as anything for these three chords. Let's look at an excerpt from an opera of 1762, Orfeo ed Eurydice, by Christoph Gluck. It's a dance interlude that later came to be famous, called the Dance of the Blessed Spirits. Chord one, the home chord, usually starts and ends a piece. Here's a score of that dance with all the chord ones marked in red. You may be thinking that red is pretty powerful, but there are still some areas of the map not yet conquered by the Red Empire. Okay, so let's show the same map with the blue chords added, eating up a bit more of the spaces that are left. The blue sections represent chord four. Now you can see there's not very much unoccupied territory left. I'll mark in the chord fives in white. So between them, our red, white and blue chords are all conquering. Nearly all of this music is either chord one, four or five. If I colour the final bits left in green, that's for all other chords, you'll see how tiny the remaining area now is, roughly a quarter of the music only. So, the empires of red, white and blue had the world of music at their feet. This was still the case nearly 50 years later. Here's a piece from 1808 by Beethoven. In this stirring section, Beethoven harmonises the whole thing with just our three main chords. It's as if Haydn, Mozart and Beethoven were reading from the same very small book of chords as a no-frills rock group. In rock and roll, those three chords are still the status quo. We're going crazy and we're going there today, here we go. But having a simplified palette of chords didn't mean composers were unimaginative or bland. It's simply that their concerns were different. Composers of this period, like its architects, were obsessed with clear form and structure. For both Haydn and Mozart, symbolism and symmetry play an important part in how they constructed their compositions. You couldn't just have random nice tunes with accompaniment, you had to have an underlying logic, like a map. Whereas in a previous era, Bach's sat-nav was calibrated mainly to seek out the meaning of the words, for Haydn and Mozart who followed him, finding the perfectly laid out route was just as essential. The building of their musical maps had its most sophisticated manifestation in the growth and popularity of the symphony. And to introduce the symphony, we need to acquaint ourselves with a little known but hugely influential composer, Johann Stamitsch. Here he is on a Czech stamp. At least someone remembers him. Stamitsch worked in the court in Mannheim, Germany, where they had an orchestra that was famous throughout Europe, both for the unusual skill of its players and for the fact it was big by the standards of the 1750s. This orchestra had 20 violins, 4 violas, 4 cellos, 2 basses, 2 flutes, 2 oboes, 2 bassoons and 4 horns, as well as 2 newfangled clarinets, much to Mozart's envy when he visited in 1777. This tally of instruments, occasionally beefed up by timpani and trumpets, was the template for the orchestra as used by Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Schubert and all their contemporaries. Importantly, Stamitsch addressed the need for a guiding structure in orchestral music. It's all to do with how he handled and shaped his tunes. He has a little phrase like this. And then repeats it. And then a second phrase, which he repeats almost unchanged. In fact, virtually every phrase you hear is repeated immediately after it's first heard. All well and good, but too much straightforward repetition could be wearing. The symphony needed more expert hands than this in order to progress. The man who shaped and developed the symphony more than any other was Joseph Haydn. Haydn's long career as a successful musician and composer spanned the entire second half of the 18th century. He was notably generous in his support of younger composers, like Mozart, a close friend who predeceased him, and Beethoven, who was for a time his pupil. The torch Haydn passed on to them was his crucial refining of the form of the symphony. Haydn took the idea of proportion and balance and went one crucial step further. His typical balancing phrase wasn't identical, but slightly different in character. It created a sense of symmetry without simply repeating itself. So in the exquisite slow movement of his 88th symphony, Haydn's first little phrase of 6 notes goes like this. Its balancing second half takes the same shape but changes the notes, so it feels like it's on a continuing journey. Then a final part, equaling in length the first 2 bits together, rounds off the phrase in a satisfying and ornamented way. This process of taking a little cell of a tune, then building on it to create longer units with more interesting features to them, is what Haydn taught the world to do, apparently effortlessly. The symphony would be nowhere without this skillful moulding of little musical ideas into a much larger structure. Haydn was so adept at this sculpting of a tune from small beginnings that the younger Mozart and Beethoven simply copied his technique. This was the point of a symphony. It was like an essay or an exceptionally long doodle. A song could be just a nice tune, plain and simple. An opera was a series of songs linked with a plot. But symphonies were supposed to be explorations, a journey to find out what would happen if you took a few tunes and mucked about with them. For sure, the symphony is a peculiar thing. 60 musicians simultaneously interpreting instructions given them by one person, with no narrative, no plot, and no literal meaning, nor is it generally a description of anything. Just four loosely related 7 or 8 minute sections of meandering music at slightly different speeds, strung together for the thought-provoking fun of it. The odd thing about the symphony at this point in history is that it doesn't have any direct parallels in any other artistic field. It's abstract, more than 120 years before the concept became fashionable in visual art. Mozart then, when he came to write his own symphonies, beginning at the age of 8, simply adopted Haydn's model. But there was one crucial difference between the two composers. Mozart was a born, unstoppable tune writer. No one who's ever lived has bettered Mozart in this respect. It's like he couldn't help it. Tunes flooded out of him, seemingly at will. And that was important because Mozart, unlike, say, Bach 50 years earlier, was mostly writing for a paying public. If they didn't like his music, he'd starve. Ravishing melodies weren't a bad way to gain the public's heart, then as now. It pains me to say it, but if you can remember a tune, it's probably by Mozart. If you can't, it's probably by Haydn. To get a feel for the satisfyingly perfect proportions of a Mozart tune, let's look at just one, the song Dove Sono from his opera The Marriage of Figaro. This song, or aria, is about a woman's distress that the happiness and romance of the early days of her marriage seem to have faded, if not entirely disappeared. It starts with a disarmingly simple 5 notes. Really, this mini phrase is just a decorative version of one note, this one, C. To complement this opening statement around the note C, it's followed by another, a little higher, on the note E. So we have two well-balanced phrases which now feel like they need an answer of some kind. The next phrase is the same length as the first two put together, and though it starts with the same rhythm, goes off on its own little voyage before coming to a sort of rest.
Then the first part of the tune is repeated. You wouldn't expect a composer as skilled as Mozart to repeat the second part exactly as it was before, though. And sure enough, his second section, having established itself, begins a gradual ascent up the musical ladder as the lyrics describe her husband's lying lips. Then it subsides again and rounds off. This is just the first 40 seconds of the aria, which has been famous for 200 years, so it must be extremely memorable. And I don't believe that's just random success. Genius though Mozart undoubtedly was, nevertheless, he also relied on the established tricks of the trade. There are some formulas at work in classic tunes, and one of them is to construct your melody around an important chord. In Mozart's time, as now, one chord was more powerful than all others, the one that belongs to the home key family at any given point in the music. So in the key family of C, it's the major chord of C. And the constituent notes in that chord are C, E, and G. Remember I said that the opening phrase of Dove Sono was basically an embellishment of one note, C. And that the second bit of the phrase did the same for E. Well, blow me down with a feather if the third phrase doesn't begin on G. Dove Sono, like countless famous and memorable tunes, is shaped from the notes of the king chord, C, E, G.
But something else emerges in Mozart beyond the sublime melodies, something that's more surprising. Mozart lived in the decorously polite, aristocratic world of Imperial Vienna, a world he never wholeheartedly embraced, which makes his operatic visions of heaven and hell, the spiritual and the carnal, weirdly unexpected.
When in Mozart's music we glimpse life's darker side, or sense loneliness or insecurity, it's as if a veil has momentarily slipped. Later composers, especially Beethoven and Berlioz, do little else than expose their internal turmoil all over the music, like they're in a modern-day self-help group of composers with personality disorders. Mozart's emotional honesty, on the other hand, is disguised beneath the decorum and poise required of an 18th-century artisan.
We know that the 1770s and 80s were dirty, unhealthy, dangerous and grim for anyone but the most privileged. But it wouldn't occur to Mozart to reproduce that misery.
Like the portraits Gainsborough and Reynolds painted during Mozart's lifetime, his music says, "I'll do my best to make this beautiful, because that's what life can be at its best." painter and composer alike would have wanted to ennoble humanity. They succeeded. Mozart's dignified compassion in the face of life's challenge makes his music compelling, even when it's tranquil. We've responded to this distant Austrian's voice across the years and the continent so spontaneously because his music seems so uncluttered, without cynicism or intellectual pretension. He spent several bad-tempered years as an employee of an archbishop. For the last 10 years of his career, Mozart became what we'd call self-employed. A bit of public performing, some teaching, writing on commission to rich patrons, composing for the theatre, and producing dance music. After Mozart, the freelance portfolio career became the norm. Instead of rich employers, composers had to court popularity wherever they could with a range of potential clients and had to deal, for better or worse, with a new bourgeois audience. Mozart and Haydn are the composers in history who represent the moment of change from paid servant to freelance composer. The next star composer based in Vienna pushed this relationship between public and artist to dramatic new heights. He was Beethoven. His mission was not so much to charm or seduce his audience as to confront it. To many people, Beethoven is the very model of the tormented, misunderstood genius, a caricature of the classical composer, complete with demonic stare and perpetual bad hair day. A moody, mixed-up chap, he found himself in possession of musical talents even he couldn't quite come to terms with. The reputation and the man, though, don't always tally up. For a start, Beethoven wasn't one composer, but three. He starts off as a Mozart clone with a flair for playing the piano, turns into Haydn the sequel, and ends up isolated from the world by deafness, composing music that was to baffle, bewitch, and amaze every European musician of the next 100 years. While Beethoven devotees like to see him as a man who reinvented music from a standing start, the reality is that, like most composers, his early career finds him tuning in to the musical currents of the day and adapting them. Listen to this piece. This piano sonata is by a little-known Czech composer called Jan Dusek. Though he was based in London, Dusek's music was known to Beethoven. Now, listen to this, a piano sonata written by Beethoven a year later in 1798. Beethoven's eighth piano sonata, his Pathetique, was written when he was just 28 and still making a name for himself in Vienna. It's not difficult to hear the distinctive traces of Dussek's piano style. 7 years after composing his Pathetique sonata, Beethoven has stopped sounding like Mozart or Dussek or Haydn and started creating music beyond anything they'd imagined. The first major sign that he was breaking away from established formulas was his Eroica Symphony of 1804. This was a considerable challenge for Viennese audiences at the time. If you were used to the regular, predictable patterns of Haydn, the Eroica's many noisy surprises and unexpected changes of key were an uncomfortable mix of titillating and alarming. Most of all, the Eroica was long. Its opening movement alone is the same length as an average symphony by Haydn or Mozart. Beethoven's ambition was growing along with his music. Traditional histories like to equate Beethoven, the colossus of music in the early 1800s, with his contemporary Napoleon Bonaparte, revolutionary turned emperor and serial military adventurer. The Eroica Symphony was originally dedicated to Napoleon Bonaparte. Legend has it that Beethoven angrily scratched Bonaparte's name from the score when Napoleon declared himself emperor in 1804. It's a good yarn, but recent research suggests it might instead be, alas, a myth. Perhaps what Beethoven was really appalled by wasn't so much Napoleon's imperial pretensions, but the unravelling of the high-minded aspirations of the French Revolution itself. The descent into cruelty and unfairness, merely dressed in new colours. This despair is reflected in the music, but it's not to be found in the opening movement. Musicologists love to wax on about the ambitious first movement of the Eroica Symphony, mainly because it's unusually long, complex and unpredictable, and provides fuel for seemingly endless analysis and scholarly scrutiny. Beethoven takes a relatively simple tune and builds from it a giant tapestry of ideas and musical meanderings. But to me, it's not the Clever Clog's first movement that carries the killer punch, but the funeral march that follows it. What's different and new about this movement is not its structure, orchestration, or technical bravado, but its attitude. Whereas both Haydn and Mozart aimed to reveal human emotions through the filter of a gentlemanly, well-bred composure, the funeral march in Eroica is remarkable for its unflinching seriousness. Grief is grief, pain is pain, and music, Beethoven seemed to be proclaiming, was the art best placed to confront such darkness. Within the next two decades or so, most of his educated contemporaries gradually came to the same conclusion. For the first time since the death of Bach, the music of the moment seemed more accurately to be attempting to portray the sadness and fear that people might actually be experiencing. And there were horrors aplenty to keep a sensitive person awake at night at the start of the 19th century. From the Eroica Symphony onwards, Beethoven's music becomes serious-minded and earnest, since it was his unabashed aim to change the world through his art. It's debatable whether he did change the world, but he certainly changed the whole perception of music. This was Beethoven's real significance. Not how he changed musical form or language, but how he recalibrated what music was for. Single-handedly, he turned it from genteel after-dinner entertainment into a state of mind that no civilized person could be without. Beethoven subsumed his own personality into his music. Whereas once music was driven by faith, beauty, or elegance, now it was fueled by a composer's own psychology.
By making the music about him and his feelings, Beethoven was taking music in a new direction. Not only was music co-opted into the personality of the composer, so was the nature all around him. Nature was ascribed human emotions. It became a metaphor for the feelings of the artist. In music, once again, this movement starts with Beethoven and his Sixth Symphony, the Pastoral, written in 1808. For the next 100 years, this symphony would act as a template for how one might portray a state of mind in musical pictures of nature. This idea of using nature as a metaphor for a composer's deepest emotions was also the hallmark of Beethoven's near contemporary, also based in Vienna, Franz Schubert. For Schubert, the birds, the bees, the woods and the trees stand for human feelings, above all in songwriting, at which he was simply unmatched before the 20th century. Schubert wrote over 600 songs before his death in 1828, aged only 31. Amongst them are three outstanding song cycles. Had they been written in the 1960s, these song cycles would have been released as concept albums.
If these songs for solo voice and piano and the thousands of others that gushed out of composers in the first half of the 19th century seem to us to be rather immature or naive in their treatment of love, it's because these songwriters were young. Their emotional development, age 25, was probably equivalent to a modern-day school leaver. These men lived at the same time as Jane Austen, but compared to her sophistication and emotional intelligence, they're like teenagers.
You can't escape the fact that the study of the first half of the 19th century in music is the study of young men with little or no idea how to relate to women. A poignant example is Abendstern, or Evening Star, composed when Schubert was pining for an 18-year-old piano pupil of his. Class, wealth, social norms, and her indifference divided them. The song treats with great sensitivity the pain and loneliness of unfulfilled love.
Was weilst du einsam an dem Himmel, o schöne Stern, und bist so mild? Warum entfällt das funkelnde Gewimmel der Brille? Ich sehe schon. keinen Keim und bleibe trauen still daheim.
Schubert's songs were meant to sound like upmarket folk songs, immediately memorable, lyrically easily understandable, and relatively predictable in shape. In a sense, Schubert is the inventor of the three-minute voice and piano song, a form that is thoroughly alive today. Its object. Schubert's songs and Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony had set the template for using nature as a metaphor for human emotion. But they also sowed the seeds of another movement, that of painting a picture in sound. This became enormously fashionable and produced a whole wave of composer-painters. And no one evoked a picture in sound better than Felix Mendelssohn. In this irresistibly enjoyable overture, A Midsummer Night's Dream, still popular 200 years later, it isn't difficult to imagine the dancing fairies, the mischief of Puck, and the playful confusion of lovers lost in a forest. Mendelssohn could whip up a musical miniature of a play, a poem, a painting, a person, or a place. A famous example is the overture to Fingal's Cave, written after a trip Mendelssohn took to the craggy shores of the Hebrides in 1829. But while this appealing music was being written, another very different sort of music was also being produced. It was loud, long, grandiose, and argumentative. Once again, this tendency can be traced back to Beethoven. Just as the age of steam was producing ever greater industrial forces, so too Beethoven, in his Seventh Symphony of 1812, was unleashing music on a newly forceful scale. Here, Beethoven creates a heavier, more imposing sound from an ever larger orchestra. The symphony orchestra is now a powerful, awe-inspiring organism. Like the colossal industries that were roaring into life around them, these mighty walls of orchestral muscle provided a soundtrack for a daunting new age. But if audiences reacted with amazement to the magnitude of his Seventh Symphony, it was as nothing to what Beethoven let rip 12 years later. His Ninth Symphony single-handedly announced that the form of the symphony was henceforth to be on an epic scale. It concluded with a now iconic anthem. The Ode to Joy is based on a poem by the German writer Friedrich Schiller. It's nothing less than a call for universal brotherhood. It was revealed to the world in two subscription concerts, a fortnight apart,
one full of admirers and close friends, the other almost empty as the public came to grips with Beethoven's modernity. Beethoven was saying that the symphony, instead of being about music, should now be about the world. Never has an invitation to young composers been more enthusiastically embraced. The coming decades were to be about music taking on the task of reforming humanity, dreaming a new utopia, and leading the arts to unite mankind. The irony of what happened after Beethoven's Ninth is that what Beethoven himself did next was the exact opposite. He turned his back on the vast scale of the Ninth Symphony to something smaller and more intimate.
In the last 2 years of his life, now profoundly deaf and mostly bedridden from severe illness, Beethoven withdrew into a private sound world, composing six string quartets of astonishing intensity and modernity. By modern, I don't mean by the standards of 1826, I mean by the standards of a century later. These late quartets are almost embarrassingly private. It's as if he was working out some tortured mind game on the page, or distracting himself from an unbearable sadness. Most of his contemporaries didn't know what to make of these late quartets. Could Beethoven hear the music of the future? If this was it, his vision was a bleak, uneasy one. The small scale and intensity of feeling that bleeds through these late quartets was echoed by some of the composers who followed Beethoven after his death in 1827. One such was to become a very different kind of piano virtuoso to the crowd-pulling pyrotechnical maestro that Beethoven had been at the start of his career, the Polish composer Frédéric Chopin. Of the generation that followed immediately after Beethoven, Chopin is the one whose influence was slowest to make its impact. The reason being that, like Beethoven's late quartets, Chopin's music is unusually intimate. Because he preferred not to perform in large concert halls, loudly, as was the vogue, but in small salons and private homes, quietly, his fame spread person by person, fan by fan. In this respect, he's more like a novelist than a composer, as people fell for his music like they would a secret love. Chopin was an exile from his Polish homeland, at that time swallowed up in the Russian Empire. His longing for his country is expressed with exquisite melancholy in nearly all of his pieces for solo piano. Chopin's music was the flip side of the concert hall symphony orchestra experience. Music to be shared amongst a few mates in the privacy of your front room, a pursuit that lasted in many homes till the Second World War. This was the beginning of an era of amateur musicianship, a mass movement of music making which centered indispensably on the piano. From the early 19th century on, the new middle class proudly installed factory-made pianos in their drawing rooms and needed music to play on them. To meet this new market, a tidal wave of sheet music was published, of both classical and popular music. Before gramophones and radios, the piano was the only source of music in many a middle-class home. Here was a chance to make music for a large body of people who up to now had been excluded from playing in orchestras and from composing. Women. Whilst it might be possible, with good reading and writing, to become the author of a novel, as Jane Austen, the Bronte sisters, or George Eliot proved, it's practically impossible to write a symphony or an opera without years of instruction and specialist knowledge. Playing the piano became a social accomplishment for middle-class women, but more importantly, it gave them a chance to compose. Here's a tantalising example, a sparkling vignette composed by Felix Mendelssohn's talented older sister, Fanny. As with her brother's music, it conjures up a picture in sound. A chilly February day. One of the most famous concert pianists of the 19th century was a close contemporary and friend of Fanny Mendelssohn's, Clara Wieck, who later married the composer Robert Schumann. Whereas Schubert's love songs are about women as unattainable objects of desire, Schumann's were written with a real flesh-and-blood woman in mind and an equal partner. Clara was the inspiration for some of Schumann's most achingly beautiful love songs. As one of Europe's leading pianists, Clara Schumann tirelessly promoted her husband's works. She also championed the works of Chopin and travelled the world to perform his subtle, deceptively complex music. Perhaps no other composer ever made the hours of practice necessary to play his music more worth the candle. Chopin's rich and ambiguous harmonies, interwoven intricately between the hands, look to the future, leaving behind the primary colour certainties of Mozart, Haydn and early Beethoven once and for all. After a period of simplicity, music's pendulum was swinging back towards complexity again. There's a delicacy and gentleness to his music, though, that represents the final curtain call of the age of elegance and gracefulness, of sense and sensibility. His heroes were Mozart and Bach, composers for whose music dignity was everything. One of Chopin's very last pieces was a barcarolle, a lilting gondola song. He admitted being terrified of death. Perhaps he dreamed up this soothing boat ride to calm his anxiety, or to remind himself of simpler times. Thank you. After Beethoven's death in 1827, a kind of parting of the waves took place between two versions of what a composer might do, whether to curry favour with an audience or become a misunderstood martyr suffering for your art. It's a rift that took nearly 200 years to heal. In the next programme, in the hands of Berlioz and Wagner, music became louder, angrier, more self-important, and more tempestuous. The second half of the 19th century saw a craze for music that was obsessed with death, doomed love, and destiny. Even popular Italian opera succumbed to it in the brilliant, passionate musical dramas of Giuseppe Verdi. The future belonged to the beautiful and the damned.
Stay with us tonight on BBC HD, a chance to catch up with Stephen Polyakov's new drama, Dancing on the Edge. Part one is coming up next.